Flo Tells All, Monday at 5.
You will hear from George Steinbrenner on the latest Yankee controversies. What are some of the worst actions of referees? And the best baseball collection anywhere.
Miller Sports Update, a presentation of Channel 2 Sports, is sponsored in part by Light Beer. Everything you always wanted in a beer and less. Here's Len Berman.
Thank you. Good evening again, everybody. It's a Sunday night in February, so what is headline news? The Yankees. I talked to George Steinbrenner tonight. I had read his comments about the Rick Cerrone arbitration case, Rick won, going from $100,000 to $440,000 a year. And I agree with George. It's ridiculous. Cerrone's been a proven Yankee for just 1 year. But I said to George, you set the overall pay scales. You paid Winfield all that money. Why blame Cerrone for going for the moon?
You must never compare eggs and apples. You don't compare Dave Winfield, who's won 4 or 5 gold gloves and is an outstanding all-around player, with Rick Cerrone, who is going to be an outstanding young player, in my opinion, but who isn't there yet. So you can't compare the two. That's what the arbitrator did. He should have been comparing him with Sundberg, Weiniger, and the other young good catchers.
He said, yes, he's disappointed with Cerrone, but no, he does not want to sign Carlton Fisk. And he told me, no, he doesn't want to trade Ron Guidry to Oakland or any other place.
No, I don't want to make any Guidry deal. I appreciate the statements that came out of Ron Guidry and his agent, where he said Ron wants to be a Yankee, Ron wants to finish his career as a Yankee, and he wouldn't want to play for anyone else.
But the big question, can he sign Reggie before the season begins?
Well, I don't know. He says, I was called yesterday by the newspapers, and he said that he's going to pass go and collect $9 million, and I just reminded him that I own Boardwalk and Park Place, and I've got hotels on both properties, so he's got to get by me first.
And that's the latest on the Yankees this Sunday night in February. The Week in Review is next on Sports Update.
I'll tell you, I was a born soccer player, did everything with my feet. Took out the rubbish with my feet, made the bed with my feet, drove my mum crazy. But I finally found something I enjoy doing with my hands, drinking light beer from Miller. Light has a third less calories than the regular beer, it's less filling, but what really makes me happy is the taste. It's terrific. Now, my mum should be happy too. Look, mum, no feet.
Light beer from Miller, everything you always wanted in a beer, and less.
Another drug story hit the sports pages this week. Hollywood Henderson, the former Dallas linebacker, told a Texas newspaper that his downfall was drugs. His cocaine habit, over $1,200 a day. Drugs have surfaced in every major sport now, and you have to wonder how deep the problem really goes. In pleasanter sports news, it was the week of the All-Star Games. The NHL All-Star Game, it's the Campbells versus the Whales. Or the Jets versus the Sharks, or the Cowboys versus the Indians. Whoever it is, somebody different won it this year than the past few years. And the indoor soccer All-Star Game. Bronco Sagoda scores for the Arrows. And the East, Jungle of the Arrows on the header. And the East lost. The Knicks continue hot against Cleveland. Made it 6 straight. And then against the Pistons, 7 straight victim passing did it. They beat Phoenix for 8 tonight. The Nets are going wild, 3-point crazy against Chicago Wednesday. 2 in a row led to an overtime win, and they made it 3 in a row today. On the island last night, a great argument for overtime. The two best teams, here's St. Louis's only goal up Chico, here's the Islanders' only goal. Games start tied, when they end tied, why bother playing them in the first place? Bring on sudden death. The Rangers peppered poor Winnipeg, 55 shots, this by Talafis, the prettiest. Here's the best pass of the week. It happened last night in Toronto. Robert goes to Picard for Toronto. The Rangers' penalty killing was hapless. The closest they got last night was 5-3 on Nielsen's goal. Toronto won 6-3. Basketball star of the week. How about Steve Johnson of Oregon State? The number one Beavers beat St. John's yesterday. Johnson couldn't be stopped. Got him. Neither could Ronaldo Nehemiah, the first human to run the 50-yard hurdles in under 6 seconds, 5.98 to be exact. Here's the most intriguing sports event of the week, the Empire State Building run-up. Talk about the agony of the feet. Here's the thrill of victory, Peter Squires of Yonkers. At Daytona this week, they flipped out, and they didn't get hurt. And they had a hot time in the old town, and they didn't get scorched. Richard Petty won it. What else is new? Here's the worst fans of the week at Holy Cross. That's where the alleged Boston Point Shavers were playing. Cute. A couple of other basketball notes. Last month I mentioned the player for Tyler Junior College that he broke a backboard with a dunk before the game. They didn't have a spare backboard in Tyler, Texas, so they called the game off. Last night the same player did it again. But this time he did it in Athens, Texas, where they had two spare backboards on hand. They delayed the game an hour and then played ball. Tyler players then promised never to dunk again. And then there's Linda Page, the schoolgirl in Philadelphia. She scored 100 points in a game the other day. If the Nets are interested, if they're not interested, they should be. Linda Page for the Nets. Jaminski, as you heard, is out for the rest of the year with elbow surgery. Back with the most amazing collection of baseball stuff in just a minute.
Comes Miller time. The flag is dropped, the race is a memory. And now you're coasting into the best tasting beer you can find. Miller High Life, America's quality beer since 1855.
If you've got the time,
if you've got the time,
you've got the beer, if you've got the time.
X cars, K cars, J cars, you've been through the alphabet. But your Tri-State Toyota dealer can show you 11 Toyota models priced at $50 to $1,500 less than the lowest priced alphabet car on the market today. So come see us and drive a Toyota, the car that taught those others their ABCs. We've got them in stock right now, your Tri-State Toyota dealers.
To relax, one beer stands clear. If you've got the time, we've got the beer.
If you were watching the news yesterday, I introduced you to the most amazing collection of baseball memorabilia on earth. But as I mentioned last night, I only touched the surface. Tonight, we get to the good stuff. But if you missed last night's report, let me start at the beginning. Where would you expect to find the best baseball collection on earth? Cooperstown, New York?
Wrong. It's Barry Halper's house in central New Jersey. This beats the Hall of Fame in Cooperstown, New York, hands down.
That's true.
Hello, Len.
I like your doorbell.
Thank you.
Thank you. Let's go.
Where do I begin to tell this story? Well, how about out back by the pool?
You can sit in Yankee Stadium.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah. Anybody could have walked up to the old Yankee Stadium and walked away with the stuff.
Yep, that's what happened. There were people, the day I was there getting some of this merchandise, there was trucks. It was like a madhouse. First come, first serve.
What's this thing weigh? This Babe Ruth Plaza sign?
400 pounds.
Before we walk inside, you would put no price tag on what's in there?
I have a price tag in my head of what, like if you're talking about overall replacement.
I want to write you an open check for what's in there. How much?
It would have to be $2.5 million.
Let's go.
And inside Barry Halper's house. A walk through his home is like a walk through baseball history. All of it.
The Babe, huh?
Yeah. This thing is so real looking. People don't realize that he was this big if you get attested by the picture behind him. But, you know, 6 foot two, 2.5, 3.
This is a Madame Tussauds in London.
Right.
I was like a kid in a candy store. Babe Ruth peep shows. It's Bambino pinball machine, circa 1929 with no flippers.
Fired. You got two runs.
From 1930, play ball. Home run.
Joe DiMaggio was here.
Right.
And played this?
Played on this machine.
How'd he do? 56 straight?
After about a half. No, he got one run and then retired.
One run then retired.
Right.
But enough of the games. Let's get down to business. This is the single most phenomenal room in the history of baseball artifacts. You want balls? You've got balls. 35 alone, signed by the Babe.
This ball contains eight men who have made unassisted triple plays in baseball, including Wobbs Gans in a World Series.
You want bats? You've got bats.
Ty Cobb, 1926. This is a bat, 1904. This is Joe DiMaggio, used in 1936, his rookie year.
You want gloves? You've got gloves.
Lou Gehrig's last glove, 1939.
You want uniforms? You've got uniforms.
Now, to give you an idea of how Babe got out of shape. Len,
this is a shirt, right?
How about the pants?
This is Babe Ruth's pants?
Yeah.
We could both fit in there.
Yeah.
You want baseball cards? You've got 1 million baseball cards.
1910, Honus Wagner baseball card, Piedmont cigarette. Last card known to be sold for $15,000.
How about a pennant from the Yankees' first pennant year? How about a 1927 Yankee championship ring? How about Zualo Versailles' actual 1965 American League MVP award? But the star of this collection is obviously the Babe. His bat bag, a lock of his hair, his contract, his actual polo coat. The spirit of Babe Ruth lives in this room.
No boy ought to miss playing baseball. It develops your arm, your legs, your back, and your wrist.
How did this collection come about, you wonder? Well, it doesn't hurt to own your own paper business in New Jersey or to be a minority partner in the New York Yankees. But in reality, it all started years ago by collecting baseball cards. He collected them for years, then he traded them, bought some other items, got some things in trades, and most of the collection was assembled over the past 5 or 6 years. 2 points. With the prices of these artifacts skyrocketing, if you started now to try to assemble his collection, you couldn't do it. Secondly, none of his items are for sale. Period. Just a private hobby. Back in a minute.
Here's two good friends. Tonight is kind of
where'd he go?
The view.
I think he's lost.
Must he always gets lost. Somehow.
Hey, anybody miss me?
Sorry about that. Realize how long you've been gone.
Oh. Take a look at this.
When you want the taste of a truly great American beer, tonight let it be low and brown.
And here's to our travel agent.
Gotcha. By the way, an experience of trying on a coat, knowing that Babe Ruth actually wore it. Some people will say, who cares? But I was really touched by that. It was really fascinating to be amongst all of that baseball history. And you can touch it, unlike Cooperstown or any other museum. If you're in the media, you can touch it. He doesn't really want people coming to his house. Finally, wherever you go in sport, fans, players, coaches complain about the calls that referees make, how they affect the games. The losing team, of course, is always the most vocal. But in reality, it's not always the calls that refs make. It's the calls they don't make, the actions that referees don't take. For example, last night's Ranger game in Toronto. First goal scored by Wilf Paymont, then the players go at it. They eventually knock down the goal. Look for the referee. He just stands there and watches it all. Look at him behind the net, and he gets paid for being at the game. Then there's the winning basket in Syracuse Monday night. Marty Head collides with Gene Smith right there. Looking for the referee, right? Look at the ref. Just stands there. Finally, he puts up his arm and says, time out. 17,000 fans screaming, tie game, and look at the ref. An obvious foul one way or the other, and the referee just stands there and looks. And Syracuse beat Georgetown. And it's not only the inaction of a referee that can drive you crazy. In college ball, after the game, the media is not allowed to talk to the referee. The referee does not have to explain his actions to anybody. As one coach told me, You can question the President of the United States on his actions, but not a college basketball referee. Now that's a foul. And that'll do it. Thank you for watching. We'll see you next week on Sports Update.
Miller Sports Update, a presentation of Channel 2 Sports, has been sponsored in part by Löwenbräu. When it's time for the taste of a truly great beer, let it be Löwenbräu.